Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear reports from Dan Novak and John Russell. Then, Anna Matteo and Andrew Smith present this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. We close the show with the Lesson of the Day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first, here is Dan Novak.
Ukrainian teenager Yelisei Mamonov dreams of attending his country's top technical university one day. For now, he is gaining valuable experience at a family-run workshop making remote-controlled stretchers. They are used to rescue wounded troops as Russia's invasion continues. Yelisei, who is 14, works under his father, Dmitro, a former factory manager. He also works alongside his 10-year-old sister, Yesenia. Yelisei has already put dozens of devices into use. "We need to scale it up. We want as many as possible to be at the front so that every unit, every company has one," Yelisei said. As he spoke, a model sped down a dirt track at a training ground outside the capital, Kyiv. The Mamonovs fled the eastern city of Slovyansk shortly after Russia invaded Ukraine in February 2022. They set up production in central Ukraine, far from the bombs that once landed on their street. Reporters with the Reuters news agency recently visited their workshop. The Mamonovs showed off two models. One was a lightweight, foldable stretcher. The other was a larger tracked vehicle called a termit, or tracked modular infantry transporter. Yesenia has learned how to connect electrical parts. She changed the wheels on the smaller model, which costs about $1,900 to make. The termit's production cost is about $5,200. The business called Tank Bureau is doing great, said wife and mother Oksana. She is also involved in the project. She takes orders for frontline troops. She ignores criticism from family members and others that her children are missing out on a normal childhood. "I think that, on the contrary, when they grow up, they'll be thankful, because they'll have more skills than others," Oksana said. Drones and other high-tech devices are playing an increasingly important part in the war. Top Ukrainian officials have said there is a need to increase domestic production. The Mamonovs' business has been funded by a Ukrainian government effort to increase defense technology production. But more support may be needed to reach Dmitro's vision, a battlefield where robotics are as widespread as first aid kits. "That means mass production. That means we need a proper plan," he said. "But in order to reach this, we need a radical leap forward." I'm Dan Novak.
The city of Tokyo is launching a campaign to create couples in a country where it is increasingly common for people to be alone. Called Tokyo Futari Story, the plan aims to create couples, called futari in the Japanese language. A website offering advice and general information for possible lovebirds is online. There is also a dating app in development. The Tokyo government hopes to offer it later this year. The app will be available through phone or the web, a city official said recently. Details were still undecided. The city government would not comment on Japanese media reports that said the app will require a lot of information. Users reportedly would need to confirm their identity, such as with a driver's license, provide tax records to prove income, and sign a form that says the person is ready to get married. The reports also said the app might ask for a person's height, job, and education, but the official denied anything had been decided. Marriage is on the decline in Japan. Recent health ministry data shows that the country's birth rate fell to an all-time low in 2023. Last year, there were 474,717 marriages, down from 504,930 in 2022. Births totaled 727,277, down from 770,759 from the year before. On the national level, the government has been trying to solve a serious labor shortage. The government has promised cash payments to families with children and support for childcare providers. It has also eased immigration policy over the years to increase foreign workers. During the so-called baby boom of the 1970s, Japan recorded more than 2 million births a year. Like many young adults around the world today, fewer Japanese are interested in marriage or having children. There are concerns that Japanese workplace culture leads to extremely long hours. Such hours make it difficult to meet people outside of work. Some say raising children is too costly. The Tokyo government is also supporting events where single people can meet and couples can get counseling on marriage. In addition, lovers can have stories of how they first met turned into art, such as manga comics or even songs. I'm John Russell.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. Scientists are testing next-generation vaccines to deal with the spread of bird flu in the United States. The vaccines use the same mRNA technology that led to the development of COVID-19 shots in record time. The U.S. Agriculture Department is planning to test a vaccine developed by University of Pennsylvania researchers by giving it to cows in order to protect farm workers. They say this could lessen the chance for the virus to jump into people and mutate or change in ways that could cause human-to-human spread.
Meanwhile, officials at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services have been talking to drug makers about possible mRNA flu vaccines for people. These mRNA vaccines would be in addition to the millions of bird flu vaccines already in government hands. If there's a pandemic, there's going to be a huge demand for vaccine, said Richard Webby, a flu researcher at St. Jude Children's Research Hospital in Memphis. The more vaccines, the better, he added.
Since 2020, the bird flu virus has been spreading among different kinds of animals in many countries. In March, it was found in U.S. dairy cows. However, investigators think it may have been in cows since December. Recently, the USDA announced it had been found in alpacas for the first time. At least 3 dairy farm workers in the U.S. have been diagnosed with bird flu. Their illnesses were not severe, but earlier versions of the same H5N1 flu virus have been deadly to humans in other parts of the world. And U.S. officials are taking steps to be prepared if the virus mutates to a deadlier version or permits it to spread more easily from person to person. Health officials say they already have 2 candidate vaccines for people that appear to be well matched to the bird flu virus in U.S. dairy cows. They say hundreds of thousands of prepared vaccines could go out immediately. And nearly 10 million more treatments could be produced in a few months. The drug maker, CSL Seqirus, said the U.S. government hired it to fill and finish about 4.8 million shots that could be completed by late summer. But the production lines for flu vaccines are already working on this autumn's seasonal shots. And drug makers would have to stop the lines to produce the bird flu vaccine.
So, the government has been looking for another, faster pathway. The mRNA technology used by drug makers Moderna and Pfizer to produce the vaccines against COVID-19. Vaccine makers usually add elements of an inactive or weakened virus to the shot mixture. But with mRNA vaccines, scientists instead create a genetic material to direct the human body to produce antibodies and recognize and destroy the virus. Moderna already has a bird flu mRNA vaccine in very early testing in humans. In a statement, Moderna said they are in discussions with the U.S. government on advancing our pandemic flu candidate.
Similar work has been going on at Pfizer. Company researchers in December gave human volunteers an mRNA vaccine against a version of bird flu that is somewhat similar to the one in cows. Since then, researchers have performed a lab experiment exposing blood samples from those volunteers to the version seen in dairy cows. Pfizer said in a statement that they saw notable increases in antibody responses. As for cows, University of Pennsylvania researcher Scott Hensley worked with Nobel Prize winner Drew Weissman on an experimental vaccine similar to the Moderna one for people.
In first step testing, mice and ferrets produced high levels of bird flu virus-fighting antibodies after vaccination. In another experiment, researchers infected one group of ferrets after vaccination. Then they compared what happened to unvaccinated ferrets. All the vaccinated animals survived, and the unvaccinated did not, Hensley said. The vaccine was really successful, said Webby of St. Jude Children's Research Hospital in Memphis. His lab did that work last year in partnership with Hensley.
The cow study will be similar to the early testing done in smaller animals. The plan is for about 10 small cows to be vaccinated, half with one shot and half with another. Then their blood will be examined to look for how much bird flu fighting antibodies were produced. Hensley said that if a vaccine reduces the amount of virus in the cow, then ultimately we reduce the chance that a mutant virus that spreads in humans is going to emerge. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Anna Matteo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
Anna Matteo joins me now to talk more about today's Health and Lifestyle Report. Hi, Anna. Thanks for being here.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
There was a word at the end of your report that I was hoping you could explain for our listeners. Emerge.
Of course. So emerge has several meanings and usages. In the report, researcher Scott Hensley said that scientists want to make sure that a mutant virus that can spread among humans does not emerge. In this case, to emerge means to become known or apparent. And in fact, scientists call viruses that appear in a population for the first time emergent viruses. Emergent is the adjective form of the verb emerge.
Okay, thanks for that explanation and information, Anna. And thank you for your report.
Anytime, Ashley. Is Anna Matteo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Faith Perlow.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In lesson 44 of the series, Anna has a conflict when she goes to buy food at the grocery store. But her conflict is not with another person. Instead, it is with herself.
Anna is fighting with herself?
In a way, she is.
How is that?
Well, the problem is, Anna wants two things at the same time. And the two things don't really go together.
Now I'm curious. Let's listen to find out more about these two things and Anna's inner conflict.
Hi there, Ashley.
Anna, hi. Where are you going?
Ooh.
What was that?
I'm hungry. When I'm hungry, I only want to eat junk food. But I know I should eat healthy food. So I fight with myself. One side says, you should eat healthy food. The other side says, but I want to eat junk food.
Well, Anna, go to the giant supermarket. You should be able to find all kinds of food there for all of you.
Good idea, Ashley. See you later.
Bye, Anna.
Ah, yes. The conflict between junk food and healthy food. I think this is something many people can relate to in modern life. But faith, I suppose we should explain a bit about this word junk and what exactly we mean by junk food.
Well, I think our listeners can understand that junk food is not healthy food. In fact, it's pretty much the opposite of healthy food, in general anyway. When we use the noun junk, that means things are not valuable or things of bad quality, the kinds of things that we really don't want.
So junk food is basically food that we don't want?
Well, not exactly. The problem is, junk food sometimes tastes pretty good. It can be sweet and salty and have fat. Things that make us want to eat it. Things like salty chips with flavors that are made by mixing together chemicals. Or food with lots of fat and sugar, like some cakes or cookies.
I think this episode of Let's Learn English is going to make me hungry. So, when I think about junk food, it seems we don't want it, but at the same time, we do want it, and that creates a conflict. Let's listen to more of Lesson 44 and see how Anna deals with her conflict.
Wow, this supermarket is huge! Look at all of these fruits and vegetables. I should eat more vegetables.
Good idea, Anna. You must eat more vegetables, like celery.
Celery? Do you know what the web says about celery?
No, what?
Celery is 95% water, 100% not ice cream. I love the web.
Anna, you mustn't eat junk food. Junk food will kill you!
You are being silly.
No, you are.
No, you are.
Will you two please be nice to each other? It is important to eat healthy foods. But a little junk food will not kill me. Ice cream. Ice cream does sound good. Okay. We are in the frozen food aisle.
Ice cream.
Frozen peas.
Nobody says, frozen peas. They say, ice cream.
Frozen peas.
Ice cream.
I am not going to tell you two again. Stop fighting.
We should explain to our listeners what is going on here. In the Lesson 44 video, Anna has two small imaginary people talking to her.
And there's one of them on each of her shoulders.
One of them, who wants junk food, looks like a devil or evil spirit. And the other looks like an angel or good spirit.
In Western culture, we use this picture of an angel on one shoulder and a devil on the other to represent two different kinds of thoughts, those that make us want to do good things and those that make us want to do bad things, or sometimes just two different things.
I'm Faith Perlow, and you're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. In Lesson 44, the Healthy Food Angel talks about what Anna shouldn't eat. But notice how she says it in this sentence.
Anna, you mustn't eat junk food.
Mustn't is the contraction of the two words must not. It's a stronger and more formal sounding way of saying that you should not do something. So, Faith, I have to ask you, do you ever have an internal conflict or a fight with yourself over what you should eat?
I have, Andrew. I love ice cream, and I always keep a pint of it in my freezer. I don't eat it every day, but sometimes when I have a hard day, I reach for it. What about you, Andrew?
You know, I like ice cream too, and that sounds like something that I could also do a lot. I tend to eat pretty healthy food, but at night before I go to bed, I sometimes want something sweet or filling, like a piece of cake or bread or cookies or ice cream. So sometimes I have a little, not a fight, but a discussion with myself over whether or not I should eat them.
Our internal dialogue, or what we say to ourselves, can be interesting or even funny. But you know, I think it is okay to enjoy a guilty pleasure from time to time.
I agree. It's hard to be strict all the time. And I think that's a great expression, a guilty pleasure. Can you explain it for our listeners?
So a pleasure is something you like, but guilty is the feeling you get, or you should get if you are a good person and you've done something wrong. But a guilty pleasure is not something that is seriously wrong. It's just a little thing you like to do, something that's not harmful. But if you did it a lot, then it might be bad for you.
Right. So if I ate cookies every single night, that would not be good. But if I eat them only from time to time, it's not really harmful. So it's just a guilty pleasure. What about you, Faith? Do you have any guilty pleasures?
I do. I love eating popcorn. I love eating popcorn so much that I make it myself. So I have popcorn kernels around all the time, just waiting to be popped. Popcorn isn't necessarily bad. It is quite healthy for snacking. But my problem is the amount I eat. I can eat a lot of it. So Andrew, the devil and the angel keep fighting with each other in the Lesson 44 video. How do you think Anna can make them stop?
I'm not sure she can make them stop, but she can stop hearing them. Let's listen to the end of the video.
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! I am sick and tired of the both of you! I know what you two need.
Anna, what are you doing?
Put me down!
You two need to cool off. I am going to buy my healthy food and my junk food. Goodbye. Until next time.
When someone is angry or arguing, we say they are hot and that they need to cool off. Anna is sick and tired of all the fighting, so she puts the devil and the angel in a cold container in the store.
Well, that should cool them off.
And we'll have more to say about the expression sick and tired in another lesson of the day.
But for now, listeners, do you have any guilty pleasures? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com and let us know.
And remember that you can find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening to the Learning English Podcast. I'm Faith Perlow.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm